There are over 100,000 people homeless in Britain today. Some are in hostels and some are sleeping rough on the streets.
Sometimes I didn't have any money and the only way I could get any food was to look through dustbins. I used to feel terrible about that.
An organisation called Business Action on Homelessness aims to get the homeless and big business together.
We're based down in Surrey. You don't have a London office. And I have no idea whether we have a homelessness issue.
Over 200 companies are involved trying to put the homeless back into the workplace.
I'm just hoping I'll get a proper job sooner or later.
Taking the homeless from the street to the shop floor, the goal of this radical scheme, is to try and break the cycle of homelessness for good.
Hi, Lily. You got it.
Sam Agundy is 19 years old and homeless. Currently, he's living in a hostel and preparing to set out on a course which he hopes is going to get him a job and a stable home.
Never had a full-time or part-time job, never had any job. I've handed in CVs and have asked like if they had any like placements, vacancies, but I just get nothing. Maybe it's my experience, my age, or my CV wasn't as good. But I see that more as a challenge, you know, more as maybe for me to go and do more, you know what I mean? To go out there and to actually, you know, just show them that you really want to work, you know, you really want to try, you're not going to give up, you really know what you want, you know, and you're not going to stop at nothing. You're going to try and get it, do you know what I mean, you know?
Sam is hoping to be selected for a two-week job placement being offered by big business to homeless people. The scheme is run by an organisation called Business Action on Homelessness. Sam is here to attend a two-day introduction where suitable candidates will be chosen.
So what we're trying to do is get companies to take people out on placements, and we're trying to change the attitudes business people have towards homeless people. Now, I knew that if I went into a company and said, can you hire a lot of homeless people, they'd all say no. And in actual fact, I think many of you would all say that you prefer to go in on a placement first because there's not that huge expectation of you. What happens if I fail? So this is not about me saying to you, you're definitely going to get a job at the end of it. What this is all about is making you more employable. I know how many of you in this room are probably feeling at the moment, I am terrified by this experience. My confidence is very low. What I can assure you is it doesn't take a few days to feel like a flower that's just blossomed after a few days of being on placement.
Sam's confidence levels are very low. At age 8, he was fostered and has been in and out of care ever since.
My dad was abusing me and my sisters, and was doing PE one day, and one of the teachers noticed like scars and stuff on my back, and then they phoned social services, and social services came in and took me away, and ever since then I've been foster care.
Marks and Spencers aim to give two-week placements for up to 600 homeless people. Getting ready for day one of his placement with them is Michael Brown.
I woke up at 4 o'clock. Because I'm pleased about this training at Marks & Spencer's. And then I thought I'll go back to sleep again, and I still woke up at 5. And I've been awake since. So I'm very happy about this job.
Michael is hoping that this will lead to other things.
I'm just hoping I'll get a proper job sooner or later.
When I was working in Tesco's about 15 years ago, I didn't shave for 2 days, and he came up to me and said, why didn't you, you're going to shave this morning, tomorrow morning? I said, oh, I will do, yeah. So shops are very strict on beards.
Michael lives in a hostel in central London and has been homeless for 7 years.
This is really a kind of, oh, but people who's got haven't got homes and who's on drugs and stuff like that. So and they're homeless. So this is my only room. It's about four steps in, and where the bed is to the sink is about two or three steps to get to the sink, and it's enough for me.
What would you say your biggest fears are about today?
I don't think there's any fears. It's just hoping I won't go on the checkouts, trained on the checkouts, and that's my worst fear, because I don't like handing money, probably, because I tempting to see all that money in the till, and I that would like a snip, it's like a tenner or 20 quid, but I'm hoping that I don't be trained on the till, so I'm hoping I'll be on the a couple of days time in the warehouse or the shop floor on the food side.
David Haig Brown has been homeless for 7 months. He had been living with his wife and daughter in Malaysia, but when he lost his job, he was forced to return to the UK and find work.
I'd always look out to see if they have any of the special offers. Sometimes items are damaged and they'll sell them at cheaper. So I'd always check through just to see if there's anything I want and get it at a cheaper price.
Things didn't go as planned, and he ended up living on the streets.
When I was actually on the streets, you know, it was the only way I could survive, was for people to actually give me food.
You'd never consider stealing, though?
No, absolutely not. If I had to steal for the family, you know, that might be a different proposition, but I certainly wouldn't steal for myself.
David is desperate to get a job so that he can bring his family over to Britain.
It's hardly a full trolley, but that's normal in my situation.
David has already started his two-week placement with construction firm Waits. He's working in their site office on a manger refurbishment in the City of London.
So I have to wear gloves.
I wear gloves, yeah.
And I have to have...
You don't have to wear it.
David is an accountant by trade, but Waits are not quite sure what to do with him and have given him junior jobs.
What we're going to do first, Dave, is go right up to the roof.
Right.
And then walk down floor by floor from
today,
there.
He's been taking on a guided tour of the construction site.
Do you have lifts, or we're just climbing the stairs?
Oh, you're going to walk up the stairs.
We're going to walk all that, yeah.
And you're going to be pretty tired once you get to the top.
All right. So are you headed off anywhere in particular at the moment, or are we just wandering around?
Just having a wander about. Dustin's told me to keep you out here for a couple of hours.
Right. Oh, I see, right. So
just having a wander about, that's all it is.
Yeah. Okay. Well, all of you up here.
For a man with good qualifications and experience, being kept out here for a couple of hours is not quite what he had in mind for his placement, though he puts a brave face on things.
I think a tour like that is extremely useful because it gives me some background to help me with what I'll be doing over the next few days. Well, look how close these gloves are. They were clean this morning. Yeah, look at the muck in here.
It is a friendly environment, and to be honest, the best way of preparing, I know it sounds stupid for an interview, is to prepare for it. So, yeah, don't be afraid.
At Sam's two-day selection course, he has been groomed in the art of successful interview technique.
My main problem is probably lack of self-confidence and just get nervous a lot, do you know what I mean? You know, and anxious, and maybe because of past experiences, you know.
He'll need to work on his confidence fairly quickly, as within minutes he has an interview with the sandwich company, Pret-a-Manger.
You could have walked for miles. I want to keep going.
Do you know anything about Pret-a-Manger?
Sandwich, cafes, coffee, lattes.
a lot of those. So we're looking forward to working with customers, interacting with the customers face-to-face.
Yeah, I've always wanted to be like, work with kind of people, you know, give something back to the customer, to the people, do you know what I mean, you know, to the public, you know, help them take something back and, you know, to characterise and to talk with and, you know, and just just that whole environment, whole atmosphere.
Early mornings. Yeah. I have trouble getting up.
That's okay. Yeah.
You okay for that?
Yeah.
We start about 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
It's quite early.
Yeah.
Okay. We get out about 3 o'clock. We're out.
You would get used to it.
Yeah.
It's harder first, but you get used to
it. Yeah, first week, and then hopefully you get used to it. Yeah.
And you're ready up for it on Monday.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We're excited.
That's great. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, mate.
I look forward to Monday.
Thanks, man.
Okay.
Starting his work placement is a big step for Michael.
I am exciting.
This is the first time he has worked in over 5 years.
A little bit nervous when I'm going in there.
Hey, would you like a drink?
Okay.
You're okay? We'll just have a quick chat before training. Okay, so what are some of your expectations from the next couple of weeks then? What are you hoping to get out of it?
Enjoyment, working.
Yeah. Anything you're particularly interested in, or is it the backstage side, sort of the warehousing, or is it the...
Well, I see. I'm usually the warehouse.
Warehouse
and retail, like filling shelves up, and that's all. That's what I've been doing.
Did you work for Tesco 25 years, was that something? Yeah, I heard about that.
Yeah.
Right then, so we just need to wait now for it, because we've got quite a few other people on the induction with you, because we're actually recruiting for Christmas.
Can I go to sleep then?
Can you go to sleep? Oh dear, first morning.
I woke up at four.
Did you?
Yeah. Oh, my trousers, a shirt, and another shirt, and the jacket. I feel like I like to work right now. Exactly right now. Especially when I'm wearing this, but there's only one I haven't got, is my proper name badge. Otherwise, I'm ready to start, really.
David still isn't being stretched in his job, but today he doesn't care. For the first time in 7 months, he has finally got to speak to his wife and daughter in Malaysia.
She was quite emotional, actually. I thought she might be sort of, "Hi, Daddy, nice to hear from you." But she actually sort of, hearing my voice made her start crying, which was a bit sad. But anyway, at least we did have a chat for a bit. She said she missed me very much. And I said, "Well, I'm trying to do what I can to get back." But she found it difficult to talk. She was quite emotional. And of course, that made me feel quite sad. I mean, you know, I know there's nothing wrong with crying, but as a grown man, you know, in occasions like this, you do feel very sad. And so the old stiff upper lip does tend to quiver sometimes. Yeah.
It's 5 in the morning, and Sam is getting ready for his first day at Pret-a-Manger.
What time would you normally be up in the mornings?
About 10:30, 11:30.
Sam has to be in work by 6 a.m. When any new employee joins Pret-a-Manger, a colleague comes to meet them on the first day.
Wait, you're right. How's it going, man? You're right. Morning, man.
How are you?
I'm okay, thanks.
Abdullah Zawawi, Sam's allocated work buddy, picks him up just before 6 a.m.
Yeah, so I'm not too late or anything.
No. How did you feel?
It was good. I was excited, really excited. Can't wait to just start, you know, getting there and stuff.
So you've never worked before?
No, this is like my first time. It's like my first proper, you know, kind of potential job, hopefully. You know, fingers crossed. Thanks, cheers. Thanks a lot. Thanks. Hiya. Hey, morning. Morning, right, Dad?
Bridget.
Morning,
man. Introduce to Sam. Hi, Sam, this is Bridget.
Hi,
it's my sister Margie.
Sam. Welcome.
Thank you.
I'm here for 2 weeks. Okay. You know me already,
yeah.
So I'm not going to introduce myself again.
Yeah.
All right.
Are you ready for 6 o'clock in the morning?
Yeah.
Let's introduce the rest of the guys about 7 o'clock. Okay, so we'll pub this and go downstairs and wake up a bit. That's it. Okay. Okay, good morning. Morning.
Morning.
Morning. Morning. Morning. Right, a few introductions first. One person's called Sam, he's going to join our team.
Hello.
Okay?
Hi.
So welcome to Sam. Hope you enjoy it. Okay. How many more people do you think want to join Pret-a-Manger?
Have a guess how many people applied in 1 week.
300
a week?
800.
800? Keep going.
1,000.
Keep going.
2,000.
Keep going.
5,000.
Nearly. 4,700 people last week applied for Pret-a-Manger. Or 4,000 phone calls, 700 people through the door. Absolutely. And look, just a neat few of us. Okay. Monday morning, you know what you have to do. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we're gonna put some bread like this.
All Pret-a-Manger sandwiches are made on site. Under the watchful eye of his buddy Abdullah, it's a steep learning curve for Sam.
So obviously now you have to spread the sauce. Yeah. The way you spread it, you spread it all the way to the corners.
At Marks and Spencer's, Michael meets his buddy for the first time.
Hello, you must be Michael.
That's right.
Hi, I'm Jean. I'm your buddy for the
time. Jean.
Pleased to meet you, my dear. Okay. So how do you feel about working here?
Half and half. Excited, and the other half is the first time back to the store where I used to work about 20 years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What? In this store you were working?
No.
Oh, in the company?
Yes, yeah.
Anytime you're ready, we can go down and have a look at textiles. We were going to get you to work on menswear today,
because
we thought that would be a bit more appropriate. But because there's not many staff in today, which is nothing new, I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to work with me on my department. This is the textile area, ladies' lingerie on this side.
Yeah.
Sorry, I can't let you work on here, I'm afraid. Can't get you doing any bra measurements. Sorry about that. This is ladies' footwear, my department. See, we've got all boots on this counter here.
Yeah.
Now, I'm afraid it is quite boring, shall I say, because most of the work here is going to be filling up stock from the stockroom upstairs, and then it's keeping it tidy.
I don't mind that.
It's not rocket science, it's not the most thrilling stuff in the world, but it gets us there, you know, it gets us through the day. A lot of it is just talking to customers, answering their questions.
Oh yeah, I know that.
Yeah, and a lot of it is just pure common sense, and I'm sure you're good at that, Michael.
Oh yeah. Sometimes I'm not really good at most things.
Don't believe a word of it. Don't believe it. I'm sure you're brilliant. Those ones, so I haven't actually got those out at the moment because I've got a reduced shoe that looks very light, but that's full price. It obviously won't all go out.
Yeah.
Anything that won't go, just put to one side.
Doing okay. It's just that I don't know where most of the shoes go, so I just ask my buddy the shelf it goes on, and then I just find there's any room. If not, I'll just put it back on the cage. And I like it.
But over at Waits, David isn't liking his placement as much.
This is a wad of instructions about what is work that needs to be done on the site. I had to photocopy all this. Now what I've got to do is to staple the relevant pages together. You wonder whether I should throw a tantrum about being given a job like this, but I've only been here for a week or so. I'll be a good boy. I've also been asked to monitor the phone while the receptionist is away. Well, there we go. Here's an excellent example. Good morning, Waits Construction. Who's calling, please? Hold the line, please. And so, oh, how important. Have to find a number for Andres. Oh, here he is. Sorry to keep you waiting. Hello, Andres, I've got Graham Woods on the phone for you. Yeah, that wasn't too painful, was it?
After a slow start, Sam's getting the hang of sandwich making. It's only day one, but Sam is already enjoying being part of the team.
So we're nearly there, like 45 minutes ago upstairs.
And they're pretty easy, it's not that, really that hard. Just beforehand, just a lot of worry, a bit of anxiety. Maybe how hard it's been, because I haven't been in work for so long. But it's pretty easy.
He's doing really well for the first day. I mean, a lot of people shop the first day, but he's doing well.
Thanks.
At the end of a long day on the shop floor, Michael heads off for a well-earned drink.
Best, please.
Past problems with his drinking were to blame for making him homeless in the first place.
125, please.
I slept on the streets when I was working at Wincanton, and I slept under a bridge near a river for about 3 weeks without having a wash and a bath. And I used to have it, go into work about 6 o'clock, have a quick wash, and stay there till my work time at 8 o'clock. Then I used to go out on a bus ride to about 11, come back, then I sleep on the streets again. But now I am happy, yes. Yeah. Because I might get a very good reference from the staff at Marks & Spencer's. Might get application form and get a job.
It's early morning on day two of Sam's placement.
Oh, it's quarter past.
And are we missing anyone important?
Yeah, Sam. So hopefully he'll get here on time.
By the 7 o'clock team meeting, there's still no sign of Sam.
Any questions? No? No questions. OK, thank you very much. OK, mush, let's go.
No, I'll just put these out.
Okay, Pat.
Okay. I don't know where.
Right on the front end, just behind that mirror part. Okay. There they are, love.
Over at Marks & Spencer's, Michael's buddy Jean is called away to another department, leaving Michael all alone.
She's not here. Do you know where she's gone? Do you know where she's gone? Because I don't know what to do. Yeah, I do. Thanks.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to abandon you, love.
That's all right.
Right. I can see you're holding your own here very well, aren't you?
Good.
It's 10:30 on the morning of day two of Sam's placement, and he hasn't come to work.
Are you waiting? Are you waiting, madam? This company, they hate people being late. They don't like it. For a normal team member, if you're late one day, you lose your bonus, which is about £30 to £40 a week. If you keep doing it, you'll get warning. If you're late three times in 1 month, you might get sacked.
Yeah.
It's a big day for David. He has come to the end of his placement, and today his performance will be assessed.
I have been trying hard. I've always come to work on time and tried to be helpful and so on. But of course it's still worrying because, you know, it's the future, isn't it? And no matter how hard you try, that final decision has to be taken one way or the other.
There is a lot riding on this for David. He desperately needs a job so he'll have the money to bring his family in Malaysia over to Britain.
The other day, I just got an email from my wife, which was a bit concerning because she's naturally having financial problems. She is working, so she's able to earn some money, but she tells me she has to work part-time so that she can look after my daughter Sarah as well. So that obviously means that her income is restricted, and when we used to be a two-income household and now down to what you might describe as a half-income household, that really is a major blow. And you know, what I'm really doing this for is because I want to raise the money so that my wife and daughter can come back to the UK. So naturally, that's always at the forefront of my thoughts.
Despite a no-show on his second day, an embarrassed Sam is back at work making sandwiches.
Yeah, I woke up, it was like really late. It was about 10:30, 11, and I didn't feel like coming in and stuff because I was still getting used to it. I felt like kind of slightly under pressure to perform, and I felt like there was been a lot of expected of me and stuff, you know, and I had so many responsibilities that I had to like just be myself and not crack, you know, and stuff. So I was feeling a bit insecure and stuff, and vulnerable, especially if you haven't been in work before. Helped me just get on with it, really. So.
Quickly. Right, call me as soon as I finish, I want to meet him.
It's time for David's make or break assessment with the Waits Management and Rupert Miller from Business Action on Homelessness. But David is late.
Come on in,
right.
David.
Sorry to keep you waiting and deputising for the receptionist.
Okay.
David, what I want to do really now is just get your thoughts on what's gone on and how it's been. And
right, okay, fair enough. Well, these 2 weeks have just whizzed by.
Have they?
Yeah. So I do find that I haven't really had the opportunity to do all that I'd like to do. Mm-hmm. So. You know, I'm hoping that there's a possibility of things carrying on. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been doing jobs such as filing and photocopying and things, which are all important jobs that have to be done. Mm-hmm. But I'd like to get some broader experience, something perhaps so you can sort of more get your teeth into a project type of thing.
Mm-hmm. How are your sort of spirits and how are you feeling about the bigger picture of what you want to do next with your life?
Well, I always have been feeling up in the sense that there's a future. And obviously, there's it's very sad, the events I've gone through, having been separated from my family and mm-hmm. having that experience of sleeping on the street. But I do think that this is not going to be the rest of my life, that there's definitely a future there. And I've always felt I've got the ability to do well. I've worked before, done well, why shouldn't I do that again?
I do think, David, personally, your mindset and how you methodically sort things out and having watched you and how you jumped in to help the girls out has been fantastic. And X has said good things and DK left a little message for me as well saying mm-hmm. you performed very well. There's no doubt you've got the ability.
Yeah.
There's no doubt you've got the common sense and the intelligence, really. Mm. That's not the question. I think the question is actually finding somewhere which you would fit in for your skills.
Right.
Having heard and talked to my team. We would certainly give David a very positive reference.
Okay, well, that's nice to hear. Thank you. They seem to think that perhaps there was a little bit of a square peg in a round hole. And I think the feeling was that there would certainly be opportunities for me, but perhaps not quite in this particular office environment.
At the start of Sam's second week, he gets the chance to serve customers.
So you try to do me one breakfast baguette and one hot chocolate.
Okay, mate.
So where do you go to breakfast, of course, and then breakfast baguette? So next customer's yours.
Okay.
This will be a crucial test for his self-confidence.
Hi, mate. Have you served? Hi, next, please. Hi, mate.
Egg mayo.
Egg mayonnaise.
Ethan. 5 foot 1 change. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thanks, mate.
Our customers aren't our mates. They're a customer in our shop and a, you know, a guest in our place. So I'd rather that they weren't our mate.
Anything else, mate? Okay, 250, please, mate. Cheers.
So we might have to pull that into a little bit more focus, but we can work with that. And I think it's going to be fine. Yeah.
Anything else, mate? Thanks, mate. Anything else? Okay, mate.
Thank you.
David may not have got a job with weights, but he has finally had some good luck. An organisation associated with Business Action on Homelessness have had a fire which has destroyed some of their accounts.
They need some help with reconstructing their accounting records after the fire, and I need some help looking for work. So it's one of those very good situations where it's good for both sides. Hello,
how are you?
Thanks. This is actually going to be a job. It's a contract job. It's 6 months, but it's a good stepping stone that should help me looking to the future.
And the amount as well.
Right, so it automatically gives the number here.
Yeah.
Obviously, you've got to prove yourself, but I think I should do pretty well. I've done some accounting work before.
And then the physical cash itself, there's presumably a tin somewhere.
Yeah, there's a petty cash box that's kept elsewhere.
I get a key for that? Or? Yes. Okay.
Getting this job has enabled David to move out of his homeless hostel and into his own bedsit. He's one step closer to bringing his family over to the UK.
This is actually it. Yes, I've actually had to say to the job centre that I no longer need any of their benefits, and I've had to give in details of my bank account, and all the money hopefully should be coming in at the end of the month. So.
And how did that feel? How did you feel when you started putting all those pieces in place?
Well, that's great. You know, it makes you think, well, you're wanted. You've got something to contribute. So I was really pleased, yeah.
Latte.
Before his end of placement assessment, Sam has a debrief with Rupert from Business Action on Homelessness.
Overall, how's the whole experience been?
It's really good. It's really challenging as well. It was a bit hard at first, like kind of adjusting. But I got really lots of help and stuff, and they were really supportive.
Right. Tell me what's been challenging, Sam.
I suppose facing the customers, like loads of customers and stuff, yeah. And like dealing with that, and just having the confidence to deal with them and stuff.
Yeah.
And just having to wake up like really early in the morning.
So tell me what time you have to get up to be here for 6?
About 4:15 in the morning.
4:15?
Yeah.
So you tell me if I'm wrong, has that been really the hardest thing of getting in the routine of back into work?
Yeah.
I think it would be fair to say it would be a shock to anyone. It would be a shock for me to change my routine.
Yeah.
Now, tomorrow, you finish your 2-week placement.
Yeah.
If you are to get a job offer, because we don't know at the moment, we will need to talk about the whole implications of you going into full-time employment and your benefits, because it's a bit of a minefield, isn't it?
At Marks & Spencer's, Michael is about to have his assessment. He's desperate to be taken on.
Am I mentioning any of the negative parts?
Yes, I think to say that he's not confident enough as yet to
deal with customers.
Yes.
I'm a bit nervous now.
You're more nervous than our last ask, aren't you?
Oh, yeah.
Why is that?
Because I don't know what Jean will say about how I worked. And see if I get a good reference or not.
The standard of his work is very good, however, you know,
the interaction with the customers has not been.
The customers would say, well, hang on a second, that's not like anyone.
Yes, it is that Marks & Spencer standard. Someone that goes, oh, yeah. You know, so we need to be honest, but, you know, just not too negatively.
Yeah, okay.
Come on. I can't stand the waiting.
Should we go and have a quick chat then about how it's all been going? What we thought is we'd have a little group session about how everyone's felt it's gone. So perhaps we should start with you, Jean, from a buddy side of things. How have you found, Jean, the general responses to Michael being there?
There's been a lot of interest in that from colleagues, as customers as well as colleagues. I think it's made us more aware of social responsibilities we have.
And has it maybe broken down some barriers? That perception of what a homeless person is has maybe changed now through the programme?
Yes, because it puts a face onto an issue, if you like. Mm. It makes us think more about it.
Have you enjoyed your 2 weeks?
Yes, I did.
Excellent. Any highlights in terms of what sort of stood out for you on the 2 weeks?
Best one was the last two or three days of this week on the shop floor.
Have you any questions that you'd like to ask?
Is there any chance of getting a place, a job at the store in the next, say, in a couple of months' time?
Yeah, we can have a look at that for you. What we've got, a recruitment process where I'd be more than happy for you to go through. But if we give you a contact telephone number, or even if you go through one of us there, we can have a look at that for you. Okay, on behalf of Hammersmith Store, this is a certificate for you, Michael. And thank you very much for all your hard work. It's been great having you. You've got to be proud of yourself, because that's been great. Best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We do have some biscuits here, if you'd like a biscuit to celebrate.
Over at Pret-a-Manger, it's the moment of truth. Will Sam fare better than Michael?
Sam, you've changed.
Oh, you haven't got your shirt on. You're right.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, Sam. You finish tomorrow, and we talked a little bit about what you would like to do. Esther, what are your thoughts about next stage with Sam? And
next stage? I personally would really love it if you want to come and join my team here. Yeah? Again, it's your decision, and the rest of the guys have all said yes. So that's the impression you've made on them all.
So, fantastic.
Really positive.
Yeah?
What do you think to that, Sam?
Yeah, brilliant.
Yeah? And yeah. Is that what you would like to do?
Yeah. Can you see yourself working here permanently?
Maybe not permanently, but for a long time.
Not the rest of your life.
Yeah.
Not
yeah. You never know, you might have a career.
For the rest of your life.
So, you know, I've heard such positive things about your work experience, about you as a person. We would love to offer you, a full-time job in Pret-a-Manger. Start as a team member and see what happens.
I think that's brilliant. Right, marvellous, Sam.
A few months after his placement finished, Michael is still unemployed and living in a homeless hostel. He thinks his people skills probably let him down.
I was disappointed, because if I knew about this customer service and know how to do it, I'd probably be there now as well, working there now. I was to see what happens.
After successfully completing his placement, Sam has started work for real at Pret-a-Manger.
You've come to see Sam? And I'm afraid he's not here today. He phoned me late this morning to say that he wasn't coming in, so he phoned about 9:30 to let me know that he wasn't feeling up to it today. He didn't sound great on the phone. He sounded very flat and quite dull.
You're sure to come across something that takes your fancy.
He's only working 2 days a week now, which is an issue because, he's not on the rolling thing of work. He's not got the motivation to really get going and really enjoy it and be the same as everyone else who's working. Because now he comes in and he's not been here, so he's not part of the team properly, as he was during his training, which is a real shame because he's not being enabled to free himself from his situation. He's only allowed to work for 16 hours a week because the money that is generated from 16 hours a week is the maximum he can earn before he starts losing his benefits. As soon as he starts losing his benefits, he has nowhere to live because the hostel can't keep him there. So he's really in a big catch-22. So in a way, I feel that he's being made quite dependent and he's not being allowed to take the step for himself.
So I'm earning £4.75 an hour at the moment. House benefits, like £500 altogether, and then plus I have to pay rent, I have to pay service charge, weekly rent as well. So that would be basically all my money gone, right, for the whole week.
The solution would be for him to be allowed for a certain amount of time to actually work with us as a team member. If the government would allow him, maybe some time, 3 to 6 months, to actually come back to work. Not to play it coming back to work.
Oh, the gem.